So that's me, super awkwardly standing in front of 500,000 king penguins. Completely insane. But first, how did we get here? Santiago is such an interesting city, and in my opinion, a couple cool ways to get to know a city is to go to the market and take public transit. And we did both.
The boys in the better land. Drivers got names to fill two double barrels. He spits out, breathes out, only smokes carols. And he's refreshing the world in mind, body and spirit. Mind, body and spirit. You better hear it and fear it. Ah, that's the spirit.
After a few days of traveling, our trip really began. The Falkland scenery was completely different from anything I'd seen before, and just coming from Chile, it was quite a 180. A bus dropped us off in Stanley, a town with a population of about 2,000, and we were given a couple hours to walk around as they readied the ship crew. After stalking some birds and encountering a classic Falklands hailstorm, we were finally ready to board the ship. It was a magical feeling boarding in the evening hours, and I couldn't help but wander around the deck of the boat, watching the crew get ready to cast off. The interior of the boat completely stunned me, and the thought that I was going to be living in this palace for the next 19 days was hard to comprehend. Today is the first full day on the boat, and every day on the boat with outings begins with a Zodiac ride. This will be the first Zodiac ride of my life. Pretty stoked. It was a pretty bumpy day, and there's no doubt the sea was being rough with us, but our crew was made of some of the best Zodiac drivers in the world, so I wasn't stressing. I was enjoying. Our first steps onto land felt familiar of beaches I'd been to, but once a penguin first entered my line of vision, all familiarity went out the window. This is a Magellanic penguin, and here is a rockhopper. I couldn't believe how many penguins there were. To go from seeing my first penguins ever to seeing huge colonies in a matter of minutes was mind-boggling. And these guys, called black-browed albatross. Here's a pretty big colony that used this small stretch of land as a wind tunnel to fly. But I'll tell you more about these guys later. Our second outing of the day was at West Point Island. It's interesting to see how extreme weather conditions such as high winds have shaped the landscape and the animals that abide here. Here, you can see an albatross sitting on its egg adjacent to penguins. Neither of these animals have land predators here on Saunders Island, so they can live in harmony. Albatross are such large birds that they can't take off without wind. They need heavy winds to help them lift off, and that's why there are so many here on West Point Island, where the wind average speed is 27 kilometers an hour. The previous day was an incredible journey, and I couldn't wait to see what we'd be doing today. However, the ship was set to start sailing to South Georgia in the afternoon, so we only did one excursion today, but it was a really good one. The next 3 days were spent sailing to South Georgia. Unfortunately, waters were rough, and I spent the days on the ocean laying sick in bed.
Oh, I'm sailing away, my own true love.
But it was all worth it, because my mind was about to be blown.
In the morning, here's something I can send you from across the sea. From the place that I'll be landing.
I just show
him. Make sure he understands that. Hey, Mandy.
Oh, okay.
Well, quick heads up, you guys.
Yeah.
On a more serious note, the fur seals have arrived since last time we've been here, so they're scattered throughout the beach. They're being very territorial, so just be very careful. Don't run away from them. Stand your ground, and then back up slowly.
Even before disembarking from the Zodiac, our noses were welcomed to South Georgia with the stench of seals and penguin poop. And merely seconds after placing our first footsteps onto South Georgia, we were greeted by hordes of fur and elephant seals. However, like our guide Bob told us, fur seals can get aggressive, and it's important to remember that we are their guests, and us as sapiens are the ones that don't belong. It's important to always be vigilant and never let your guard down, because these guys can sneak behind you and it can be really scary. Finally, we have encountered my favorite penguin of the whole trip, the king penguin. These little homies reside in big numbers. These penguins have come to Salisbury Plain to breed, and their curiosity could keep me amused for hours. Like all penguins in the South Pole, king penguins have no land predators and have no reason to be scared of us. These are the second tallest of all penguins, below the mythical emperor penguin, and this gives the little homies a human-like quality which intrigues us all and further adds to their lovability. Today, we explore Great Viken, an old whaling station that ironically now gives home to fur and elephant seals. Today couldn't have been more beautiful, and it was without a doubt one of the highlights of South Georgia. Humans have already greatly impacted Antarctica during the whaling craze in the early 1900s, and it is vitally important that we simply observe on our excursions and leave the area untouched. Today, an inspector is coming and checking our boat to ensure that everything is as clean as it needs to be. It is crucial that we don't bring outside plant and rock matter to the places we are visiting. This procedure is called the biosecurity inspection and requires a passing grade of 90%. A toast to Shackleton's grave, and we were on our way. I find it incredibly fascinating how these animals unknowingly reclaimed a former place of mass genocide for their species. Great Viken was the first time that we truly got to see a glimpse of what life was like for the first humans to inhabit this extreme continent. While the whalers are looked down upon today, for good reason, we must not forget to credit them as one of Antarctica's first explorers. And although the whalers led tough lives, I'm sure that the natural beauty of this landscape was not lost on them. I imagined camping adventures through these mountains, and I felt a true connection with the scale of the peaks. Jagged overhanging cliffs were unlike anything I'd seen before. A moment of reflection was required. Since we are now in South Georgia, we had to be extra careful of biosecurity, and we would wash our shoes in this machine after every outing. Sometimes, filming everything can be mentally exhausting and can take away from the experience of the trip. So for this sighting, I decided not to film anything and just take a few pictures and really enjoy it. Stromness Harbor was a magnificent place, and although there was little wildlife, the natural landscape spoke for itself. Walking in between giant peaks and ending up drinking the freshest water in the world was a great end to a phenomenal day. Underneath all the excitement of the previous days, the hype for St. Andrew's Bay was building. It's the largest king penguin colony in the world, and our expedition leader planned to wake us up early to see the sunrise. However, the weather had something else in store for us, and we were swept with tremendous winds, over 100 knots. So, we only did one outing to Ocean Harbor, where it was less windy. The footage from this day speaks for itself, and we planned on going to St. Andrews Bay the following day. Ocean Harbor was an old whaling station, but we weren't allowed within 100 meters of the station due to preservation reasons. Our outing consisted of a beautiful walk through spongy moss and surrounded by mountains, only to find ourselves at the base of a breathtaking waterfall. And littered along the way lay seals of all types. We wandered around for a little while, and then were invited to go on a Zodiac cruise where we would get a closer look at the elephant and fur seals. Fortunately for you guys, I am unable to transmit smell through this video. The sounds of these great beasts is why I so often compared them to real life sea monsters. Since this was our only outing of the day, we spent more time here than we usually would, and we got to experience beautiful light changes over the mountains. I couldn't wait for tomorrow. The day was finally here, leaving on a Zodiac at 4:45 a.m. to experience sunrise at the largest king penguin colony in the world. I couldn't hold my excitement, and I was close to jumping off the boat and swimming there. No words can describe such a tremendous experience with nature, so I'll just let the film speak for a while.
Must be some kind of way out of here, said a joker to the thief. There's too much confusion, I can't get no relief. Businessman there, drink my wine, plowman dig my earth. None will level on the mine. Nobody of it is worth.
Oh my God, there's four. Remember this picture? That's here. We'll be right back. I did my first time lapses of the trip here, and it was such a good idea. I'm so stoked with how they turned out, and it's so cool seeing what the animals do when left unattended. St. Andrews Bay was incredible, and I'll never be able to recreate the feeling of putting first footsteps on that beach. However, now we had another few days of sailing, and I really wasn't looking forward to it after how sick I got the first time. But this time was different. The seas were calmer, and we got to sail through the Weddell Sea, a sea known for having beautiful icebergs littered along the water. Once again, I was up early to experience the beauty. Although there were many, this is an example of a situation where I really struggled just having a GoPro. I couldn't even get half as close as I needed, so I mainly took pictures. And just to show the size of these icebergs, these little black dots are penguins. And the cherry on top of the cake? Just by chance, we ran into the world's biggest iceberg. It's over 180 kilometers long and took us over 4 hours to get around. Worth every second. After an eventful few days of sailing the Scotia Sea, we arrived in Antarctica. Here awaited new animal species and landscapes unique to the South Pole. Icebergs scattered across the sea, and whale spottings were a near daily occurrence. I find it super cool to see orcas in their natural environment, and to think that so many orcas live in BC shows how versatile the species is. Our first stop in Antarctica, Paulet Island. It's an old Swedish explorer station overrun by Adelie penguins, which are most definitely the creepiest of the penguin species in my opinion. And although the island is relatively small, it packs quite a punch. It blew my mind to see how these tiny, seemingly incapable penguins were able to climb mountains and move around relatively large rocks which they use to make their nests. However, penguins can get lazy, and we saw a few instances of penguins trying to steal rocks from other penguins' nests. If they were caught, a fight would ensue. This is actually a photograph of the Adelie's mating. At Brown Bluff, we placed our first footsteps onto the actual Antarctic continent, as we had only been on islands before. Winds were rough, and we couldn't stay long, but our expedition leader decided to take the risk and at least get us to step foot on the continent, which was super cool. cute little fellas are called Gentoo penguins. Today, we head out to Hydruga Rocks, a small island inhabited by chinstrap penguins. But the penguins weren't what caught my eye. It was the first time we were able to get up close to the icebergs, and they completely captivated my attention. I even asked one of the guides to let me go ride around on the Zodiac with him so I could get an even closer look at the icebergs. These things are truly magnificent. There are so many things we do that affect these penguins, and even the footprints we leave in the snow can cause them to get stuck, so it's important we minimize where we walk and stay on the trails that the guides pioneered for us. This has to be one of my favorite days of the whole trip, and was definitely my favorite landscape. But the day wasn't over yet. Unbeknownst to us, our expedition leader had something very special planned for the afternoon if conditions were just right. Today was a sad yet exciting day. It was our last day before we began sailing back, so I knew I had to squeeze every drop out of today's outings. However, the morning was exciting because I was going to go out and actually do some science with my parents and a couple guides. The whole reason I'm on this trip is because my parents are scientists and they got invited to come, so it seems fitting to do some sampling at least once. This also feels pretty cool because we are the only ones doing this. The other passengers are just doing a Zodiac cruise. This ice may look dirty, but all that brown stuff is actually phytoplankton, which is crucial to the Antarctic ecosystem due to the fact that the krill survive off phytoplankton, and krill are the basis for the entire food chain. Now I'm gonna let Bob take over.
We've teamed up with scientists from really all over the planet. They're trying to get a better understanding of what's going on here on the peninsula, especially on the peninsula, because it's the most susceptible to the changing climate. And they're not able to get here maybe once a month every season, while we're here, tourist operators are here for 5 months out of the season, so we got a much bigger window. One of the big things that they're worried about is all as the air temperatures are starting to increase and water temperatures are being increased in the area, are the glaciers that are starting to melt, and all the glaciers are fresh water. So that fresh water is starting to come into these ecosystems, these saline marine ecosystems, and they're thinking that it might change a little bit of what's going on historically. And one of the big concerns is phytoplankton. And in the fjords of the, especially in the fjords of the Western Antarctic Peninsula. So what we're doing, Scripps Institution of Oceanography has put together this huge program to figure out what might be happening and how the phytoplankton in these fjords might be influenced. And the big thing, why are we concerned about the phytoplankton? Because the krill eat phytoplankton, and everything in this area, the entire ecosystem biologically, is dependent upon krill, from the penguins all the way up to the cetaceans. So you guys can kind of understand why we want to know what's happening with the phytoplankton. But it's all about...
Isn't it like also like a lot of oxygen? Phytoplankton produce?
Yeah, phytoplankton produce a 50%. Lot of oxygen, 50% on the planet wise. Yeah, absolutely. So that's very important as well.
They suck down a lot of CO2 also.
Yeah. Yes, they fix CO2.
Remarkably different from each other. So different species have completely different forms. The form that the krill really like look a little bit like a glass tube with these kind of like, they look like glass tricules or glass point hairs at the end. And those are very easy for the krill that are feeding like this to grab. And so when you get more fresh water, even just a, you know, fraction of a percentage point change, certain plankton are able to thrive more easily than others. And it seems that the one that's thriving now under these less saline conditions is a round one. And the krill are not able to grab the round one. So even if you don't have an absolute decrease in plankton count, like measured with the Secchi disc, you might not see a difference necessarily, but the composition of the plankton has completely changed. So that's why it's important that these samples we're taking aren't just gross amounts of plankton. They're going back and they're getting genetically analyzed for ones that are actually functional members of this food chain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You do, but you don't have
don't
to if you don't
no.
want
to.
You different jumps? I don't, what's the water
so what
depth
is that?
Here?
And then you're going to drop this over the side. And when it disappears, you just let watch it. You see it still?
Yeah.
I know, seriously.
Yes, buddy. I got to get the air.
This sounds so awesome.
Yeah.
What's up, Bob?
10 minutes.
Alright, looking?
We'll see.
Alright, and you tell me when to start pumping.
Go for it.
Can you just keep it like 3 inches further back just because I want to get some of these on the video?
Yeah, yeah. You're doing the capsule?
I'll fight the
fat. Yeah, that's
a Doberman. There's, you see the white, the original white of the filter, and that's what we got.
After that lame-ass science was finally over, we got back to the good stuff, looking at penguins.
So funny if one of them fell.
Holly came from Miami, FLA.
And I was lucky enough to get some pretty incredible shots.
USA. Plucked her eyebrows on the way, shaved her legs, and then he was a she. She says, hey babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey honey, take a walk on the wild side. Candy came from out on the island. In the bathroom, she was everybody's darling. But she never lost her head, even when she was given head. She says, hey babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey babe, take a walk on the wild side.
and the colored girls go do 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 do. Gave it away. Everybody had to pay and pay. A hustle here and a hustle there. New York City is the place where they said, hey babe, take a walk on the wild side. I said, hey Joe, take a walk on the wild side.
Look, we're like in the ice now.
Sugar Plum Fairy came and hit the streets.
I was excited to get to our final outing of the day, and of the whole trip, but first we had to cross the infamous La Mer Channel. It's known for being incredibly difficult to pass due to ice blockages, so you can imagine my amazement when I saw the channel was ice-free. Soaring peaks on each side, the La Mer Channel is one of the true natural beauties of this planet.
Apollo, you should have seen him go, go, go. They said, hey, sugar, take a walk on the wild side. I said, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. All right. Ha. Jackie is just speeding away. Thought she was James Dean for a day. Then I guess she had to crash. Valium would have helped that patch. I said, hey babe, take a walk on the wild side. I said, hey honey, take a walk on the wild.
And we have arrived at our final outing, the ice graveyard, where icebergs either float in to die or get swept up in westerly winds and taken to sea. A simple Zodiac tour through a foggy ice graveyard. There's nothing better than that.
There must be some way out of here, said the Joker to the thief. There's too much confusion, I can't get no relief. Businessmen, they drink my wine, plowmen dig my earth. None of them along the line know what any of it is worth. The thief, he kindly spoke.
Icebergs really did mesmerize me, and I just found the seemingly impossible structures of ice truly magical. I love seeing the icebergs and just thinking to myself, how the fuck is that possible?
And this is not our fate, so let us not talk falsely now.
What a way to end an Antarctic expedition. I just want to say thank you to my parents, all the staff on board the Magellan, and Worldwide Quest for making this dream a reality. But most importantly, the Antarctic continent itself, and all the animals that welcomed us with open arms. Thank you. Sailing back was calm, and I had time to reflect on all the incredible experiences I had, and all the wonderful and interesting people I'd met. And although I was sad, I didn't know how, but I knew I'd be back someday.